Please hold the line. We will answer your call as soon as possible.
Today, my guest on Please Hold is Adam Jackson. Adam is the co-founder of Doctor On Demand, a fascinating company that lets you get a doctor virtually from anywhere you are to address any problem you have medically. And he is now working on Dopamine Labs, applying AI to different digital products. Whatever works, they ship. Whatever doesn't, they go back to the drawing board. And it's sort of just a playground for that kind of stuff. So happy to have you on today.
Thanks for having me.
So I wanted to start at the beginning. You went to Vanderbilt.
I did.
And then you started working at different companies. Mm-hmm. And you either had ADD or something, right? Because you went to smallbusiness.com, Renal Care Group, and WebMagic, all for about a year.
Well, those were all actually, the first two were internships during college in Nashville.
Okay.
And then my first sort of real job out of school was at WebMagic down in Pasadena. Great serial entrepreneur, Greg McLemore, who did pets.com and toys.com back mm-hmm. in the day. Made some good money before the winter. And that was my first programming job. I was there for maybe a year, year and a half, and then decided to go off on my own. That's
okay.
how I ended up in San Francisco.
So the first two companies, it was intentionally a year because it was an internship,
yep.
and then WebMagic was also about a year. What did you learn in those 3 years that made you, went and started MarketSquare.com?
Mm-hmm.
Was there something that just clicked? Did you always know you wanted to do your own thing, or did that evolve?
Well, I learned from those three jobs and many other experiences that I make a very poor employee.
Why?
I don't know. I think I have an innate problem with authority, which probably a lot of people I've worked with over the years can probably attest to. I just like professional autonomy. You know, I really enjoy being self-directed, that kind of thing. So while those jobs were awesome experiences and I became a much better developer and database administrator, I knew that I'd always want to, you know, do something on my own. So I packed up out of LA, came to San Francisco, and rented a little 10x10 room in the Presidio for $500 a month. And really,
it's a fancy first gig.
Yeah, I was living off consulting, you know, programming for hire kind of revenue, and you know, digging my way out of, you know, 100 plus thousand in student debt. And you know, I taught myself to surf. Like, went out to Baker Beach every morning, and that was, you know, it's a good life for a 24-year-old. So that's where my entrepreneurial roots kind of started.
So it was never a question for you that you were going to go out and do your own thing?
Right.
Okay. Tell me about Market Square.
Yeah, Market Square was, I was building software to solve one of my own problems. So I remember I was dating this girl at the time, and you know, we would go around on Saturday. I always thought Saturdays should be fun days, like we should do stuff you want to do, not stuff you have to do. And she dragged me around to like 10 different retail stores because we were looking for a gift for a birthday party we were going to that night. I was like, what an insane waste of time doing all this shopping when we could be like out at the park or surfing or something. So I decided, you know, you can buy stuff online, but it takes 2-3 days to get here. Like, there should be a way.
This is pre-Amazon Prime, same-day delivery,
yes,
that kind of stuff.
Very much. It's like pre-local shopping. So I decided, you know, I bet I could catalog, you know, the top 50 products for a bunch of these stores, put them up on the internet, build this kind of online mall called Market Square. And I bet I could drive some revenue for these local stores. So that was the plan. I went around with my digital camera and my Excel sheet and, you know, took UPC codes off of the top 50 products. And I told the stores, don't pay me anything. Just let me know, you know, if you get customers from this. And we would set up coupons that people could print out. So we'd know, you know, redeeming that coupon means Market Square sent you the traffic.
Right.
And then I would SEO the pages, the product pages. And this is before SEO was a term as well. So there was a point in 2004 where if you typed in like bike, helmet, Berkeley, we'd be the only organic result.
Wow.
Which is absurd, right? So we were driving good, and people were searching for products with local modifiers back then. So we had 200 or so stores on the platform in San Francisco, and we're driving real revenue for them. And I ended up meeting up with my future kind of business partner, a guy who's running StepUp.com, his name's Kendall Fargo. Was doing the exact same business model, but for the big box guys, the Best Buy, Circuit City, those guys. So, and Kendall was an experienced business guy, you know, understood how the venture capital system worked. I'd never even heard that term at this point.
So this was all self-funded?
Yeah, it was all self-funded. I would program for hire during the day and then build all the software for myself at night. And you know, use the consulting revenue to start up ideas.
Yeah.
Market Square was like the fifth or sixth thing I tried that year. You know, most of the other stuff just never went anywhere. So yeah, teamed up with Kendall, who was doing the same business but on the big box scale. We merged our companies together. I became the tech platform and ran engineering. And then we went and raised some money, and 2 years later became part of Intuit, QuickBooks.
And so Intuit bought you guys. What was it like working in a much larger company?
It was a very new experience. You know, I'd never had a job in a company, you know, bigger than a couple dozen employees before that. And or not one that I paid any attention to, at least I had internships. But so it was great. Intuit's a fantastic company. You know, I learned a lot about, you know, I didn't go to business school, so like I learned some things there around like what is product management.
That's probably why you're good at business.
Maybe, yeah, there could be a negative correlation. Although I have many smart friends who happen to have an MBA and succeed despite it. But no, it was cool. But I also learned I don't like working at big companies. So at least the end of one.
And you also lasted there about a year?
I was there for a year. Yeah.
Okay. There's a theme here.
Yes.
And after that, were you simply fully vested at that point, or you had an idea you couldn't get out of your head, or what? Why'd you leave?
Yeah, it was the latter. It was a cash deal, so there was no lockup on that one, which I didn't realize at the time how lucky that was.
That's very lucky.
So by the end of that year, I'd had my idea for my second company, DriverSide. And we were actually, you know, kind of like outraising money for it at the time. So I wanted to hang on to the health insurance as long as I could, but had to eventually get out of there.
So DriverSide, it's pretty near and dear to my heart because we're all about protecting consumers mm-hmm. from bad service experiences. And DriverSide, you're actually helping people that have a car against recalls and overpaying for service and doing things like that.
Yeah.
How'd you get that idea?
Yeah, it was, so my co-founders and I always joke, we used to love cars until we got into the automotive business. We're car enthusiasts, and we wanted to build. There's this huge underserved part of the consumer market where, you know, there's tons of sites to help you buy, tons of sites to help you sell your car. But what about all the stuff you do in between? You're going to service the car, deal with recalls. You might buy aftermarket parts for it. You're going to need tires. You're going to need brakes. All these things that there's just no online resource for.
Yep.
So that was the genesis.
When you say you're a car guy, do you love classic cars? You just love cars in general?
Yeah, I mean, I love all cars. I've owned classic cars before. I've owned sports cars. You know, you can't park too many cars in San Francisco, so that's a limiting factor. But,
yes.
But yeah, I've always loved cars since I was a kid.
I always loved cars, and when I was in high school, I had to have, if a friend had an M3, I wanted an M5 and all this like crazy spoiled stuff. And now I live in Los Angeles and I pretty much ride a bicycle everywhere.
That's right, yeah.
So I've gone completely 180. And that's from a guy that's done 2 European deliveries with BMWs all over Europe and really got into cars and then...
But you got to hand it to LA though. They're much more bike friendly than they were like 10, 20 years
ago. Oh, it's changing dramatically.
Yeah.
I think the whole world is getting that way.
Yeah.
So you sold DriverSide to Advanced Auto Parts. Were you there for about a year?
18 months.
Okay.
Almost exactly.
That was 50% more.
That was the earnout.
Okay.
Not my decision.
So by 2011, you had started and sold 2 companies. How much easier was it the second time around to do that? I mean, do you ever get to a point where it's easy or it's just easier?
Yeah. I mean, different parts of it become easier. But there's always something that's hard and really sucks. And that was very true for Doctor on Demand as well. So, that was my third company. For instance, fundraising was much easier for that because I had done it twice. Mm-hmm. Also, the first two, I had amazing co-founders who are Jad Dunning and Trevor Traina, Trevor's office that we're sitting in right now, who are not only dear friends, but incredible business mentors and taught me everything about. So it helps, when you're a first-time entrepreneur and you don't know how to raise money, it helps to get a co-founder that's done it before and really, so you really get a front row seat. So by the third time, it was much easier for me to raise money, much easier for me to recruit. Like, I'm an engineer, so I understand how to recruit engineers. But everything else, it's like, it doesn't matter how many times you've done it. Like, it's fucking hard to start a business.
It is fucking hard to start a business and to scale it.
For sure.
So let's talk about Doctor On Demand. People have tried that idea before, and no one's been able to scale it, I think, like you guys. I think you're the biggest in the space. What gave you that idea?
Sure.
This was something neat.
So we're the second biggest. We have a large kind of incumbent competitor that's a telephone only system that they're in their big public company. But yeah, as far as consumer apps go, we're one of the bigger ones. So the idea for Doctor on Demand wasn't mine. My co-founder is a guy named Jay McGraw, who produces a television show that's on during the day called The Doctors. It's a medical talk show. Jay's dad is Dr. Phil from The Dr. Phil Show.
Okay.
So very well-known personality. The two of those guys, aside from being brilliant television producers, are incredible serial entrepreneurs. Now they happen to, you know, start TV shows or other kind of product lines, less so digital stuff. So they had this idea for Dr. on Demand years ago before it was even technically feasible. Mm. And then once, you know, the app economy kind of really took hold, you know, this is 2012, they asked their attorneys at Fenwick to help them find somebody in the Valley that could help build and run this thing. And I was put somewhere on that list, probably five or six no's before they got to me. But when they called me, I was just running up on my 18 months at Advance.
Good timing.
It was great timing. Met Jay, really sharp guy. You know, it was he and I are very similar in so many ways. So it was sort of like instant friendship.
Fenwick and West, the entrepreneurial matchmaker. I had no
Thank
idea.
Thank you, Fenwick. Yeah, they've been billing me for it ever since.
And so when you heard of the idea, was the pitch really simple? If somebody needs to talk to a doctor, they should be able to wherever and whenever they want to?
Yeah. The pitch was, look, it's a pain in the ass to go to get a primary care appointment. The average wait time is 2 weeks in the United States. Or you go to urgent care, sit in the waiting room with all these super sick people for hours, and it costs you a couple $100. Mm-hmm. When so many of these cases, you know, cold, cough, flu, sinus infection, rash, pink eye for your little kid, a minor injury. So many of these things can be done well over video. So the concept was simple that they pitched me. You build a great app that works on video on any device, build a great network of doctors in as many states as we can get, and we'll talk about it on the TV shows. We'll see what happens. So that's
what sort of like Ellen coming to you being like, build something and I'll talk about it a little bit.
Yeah, except bigger audience than hers.
Dr. Phil's a bigger audience than Ellen?
I think Phil's got a slightly bigger audience, yeah.
That's insane.
Yeah, but I would definitely not say no to Ellen. Okay. I mean, I would literally create any piece of software she wanted.
And so tell me about the doctors. Are they moonlighting?
Yeah, so initially, yes. Initially, they were men and women who, you know, had day jobs, or maybe they're ER doctors and they work 3 days straight and then they have 4 days off. So mm-hmm. they'll work for us in those 4 days. And then as the business grew, as you can imagine, you know, not unlike your business, you know, you're doing this labor side marketplace. So you've got to kind of grow demand, grow supply. And our supply happens to be very expensive and has lots of other better things to do. So, you know, that was a tricky part of the business. And now that we're bigger, we actually have a fair number, you know, a few dozen full-time doctors that, you know, just work for Doctor on Demand primarily.
Okay. And they're spending most of their day in front of a phone on FaceTime or
It's a funny story. I was so excited to have, you know, an iOS iPad app for the doctors, and we were in private beta with it, and you know, I'd have my friends calling in as patients, you know, routing to just these couple doctors we had, not doing real medical visits, just testing the tech. And you know, the doctors are like walking around with their iPads, and the video quality was such shit. Then like it looked super sketchy from the patient side. You're like, this isn't a real doctor. Like, how am I looking at the ceiling the whole time? And you know, you're like, the lighting was always bad. So we learned early on, like, if consumers are going to adopt this technology and do this, trust us instead of going to the offline doctor, we've got to make it look like a real doctor visit. So we killed the iOS app, make the providers sit in front of a MacBook. Put a little LED light on it that properly illuminates their face, got them a white lab coat with the Doctor on a Man logo, and have a little script that they read when they first answer the call.
And it's just FaceTime?
It's live encrypted video. We don't use FaceTime because it's Apple.
It's your own platform.
It's our own version of FaceTime.
Got it.
But it works on web, Android, or iOS.
Okay.
And it's all encrypted, so, you know, there's not, you know, hackers stealing the videos and all that stuff.
Yeah, so I'm never going to get a doctor that's like eating a sandwich at lunch and he's also, you know, helping you diagnose your fever.
So I can't say that that's never happened. It almost never happens.
It's not the idea.
It's not the idea. Certainly, we would love to hear about that if that happens.
Fair enough. So how far can you take that? I think last week, read an article that computers now with a camera can actually detect what might be skin cancer better than a doctor.
Yeah.
Which is incredible. How far can this go? I assume you're never going to do virtual surgery, but as far as diagnosis and treatments, where can you take it?
I mean, I just read something earlier that says that some doctors were saying we should stop training radiologists because the AI systems have gotten so good at reading radiology charts that we're not going to need them radiologists in 5-10 years. Plus, that's a very expensive provider type. There's two answers. The first answer is the technology is there. Like, it is that good. You can, in derm, in radiology, in ophthalmology, there's some amazing technology that does do better than the provider. But the real answer is we are a long way away from machines practicing medicine. And that's mostly a regulatory issue. FDA says, and others say, software can help, but there's still got to be a real doctor on the other side.
Today, with Doctor on Demand, if I have a suspicious mole and I'm wondering if it's skin cancer, is that a good use of the service?
Yeah, it is actually. We can take a look at it for you. We can send over high-res images during the video consult, so the doctor, she can actually zoom right in and see what's going on. If there's any chance, that it could be something serious, we'll do a referral to a dermatologist for you and send along that note so he or she knows kind of what the first visit was all about. People use that for all
time. Are you covered by insurance?
Yeah, we are. That was a big part of Doctor on Demand's sort of expansion in the
Is
last
that hard to
years.
Do?
Yeah, it's really hard to do. So we take, we sell to self-insured employers who provide us our service to their employees for free. So Comcast, Home Depot, Walmart are examples of that. For free or for, it's in your plan design. If you have a high deductible, then you gotta use that deductible first. So there's a bunch of ways that works. And then with insurance companies, we're in network with United, which is the largest carrier in the US, and a bunch of the Blues. And those are tough deals. That's, I would say 1 year to sort of win the RFP and get to yes, 1 year to negotiate the contract, and 1 year to implement.
Wow.
And that happens serially, of course, nothing in parallel. So, we're into our third or something year with United. It's kind of just getting off the ground. I mean, they're a great partner. But that is a highly regulated industry. And, by default, they just don't move quickly. So a lot of health tech startups will simply just run out of runway before they can get the deal done.
It's a great barrier to entry for you.
It is. Yeah, we don't have a ton of competition because of these ridiculous hurdles.
Yeah, that makes sense. So I was watching an interview where you were talking about raising money, and you said when selling to investors, you have to create FOMO, or not much is going to happen. Give me an example of when you've done that in the past.
Yeah. We did it. Try to do it every time we go out. But for example, our seed round. We raised a $3 million note when we started. And
it's quite a big seed.
Yeah, we were targeting one, and it got oversubscribed. And I have a policy of never saying no to more investment money. Actually, that was my old policy. Now I say no to all investor money. Pendulum is swung the other way.
I'll ask you why you did the 180 after that.
I'm a bootstrapper now, and we can talk about that later. So what we did was, we filled the note with strategic investors, individuals, as well as institutions. My plan was to get 5 venture firms into the note, and we succeeded at doing that. And in great firms, Google Ventures, Andreessen Horowitz, Shasta Ventures, handful of others, and then a bunch of individuals. And then what that did was it gave us a ton of runway to get the product built, build the network of providers, and get up to a nice launch. Hire a good PR firm, do a proper launch, and then go out for Series A with a good amount of buzz and at least hopefully 5 venture firms competing for the deal. And it worked as designed. It went well.
Pretty good. So let's talk about Dopamine Labs. You're trying to make everyday tasks easier using AI. Is that a good description?
Yeah, I mean, that's kind of the lens we look at it through. So we build, we're a couple engineers, a couple designers, and it's all self-funded, myself and a couple friends. We're just a little studio around the corner that we're building new either SaaS or mobile products, so super high margin, really scalable stuff.
Your own ideas?
Our own ideas, yeah. But you can't apply, there's nothing to apply to. It's just stuff we think of. And then So SaaS or mobile with AI machine learning twist on it, right? I think
there's... I feel like you just hit every single buzzword.
I know,
that's
it's
hot
so
right
unfortunate.
Now
yeah, it's, you know, when I took, after I unwound day-to-day at Doctor on Demand, I took the summer off and spent 3 months learning all the new machine learning algorithms and how this whole world, because I was in a bunker for 4 years running Doctor on Demand, and you know, I lifted my head up, I'm like, holy shit, this is all real now. Like, machine learning's been around forever, but like now it works, and mm-hmm. now we have the GPUs and all the great algorithms are open source. So, you know, every industry is gonna be touched by this somehow. You know, Facebook's already doing it and Google in really meaningful ways. But every industry will change, just software, right? Everything, every category of software will change meaningfully because of AI. So that's our premise, and then figure out how to build, you know, clever and scalable SaaS companies out of that.
Going back to what you said before, you said you never said no to money. Now you're not saying yes to money. Why?
Yeah, I mean, there are such great advantages to raising a lot of money, like we did with Doctor on Demand. We raised $86 million over 3 rounds. And we couldn't have gotten where we are without that. And our investors are incredibly helpful. I have a personal friendship with every one of them. They, you know, and it's a wide array of, you know, healthcare, tech, Qualcomm's in there, Dignity's in there, you know, so you have a good mixture. All of them really helpful in their own way. But, you know, running a company and having lots of constituencies and lots of responsibility to the board and all that, you know, it's just a very different experience than, you know, working with a couple engineers and, you know, self-funding the whole thing, you know. And once we get a product that, you know, is post-revenue, already profitable, it's very simple to either raise money or just let the revenue grow the business.
Yeah, so why raise money at that point? You've done the hard part.
Well, raise money if you can do super favorable terms and stomp on the gas pedal. So yeah. It's not like I'll never raise money again. That we would do it in that case. But I like you know, building really scalable stuff out the door. And you know, if I want to like not show up for a week or two, then like nobody cares. No one misses me. You know? It's that sort of.
So you literally have no boss right now.
Yeah. Other than my wife and children. But yes, no professional boss.
Of course, that goes without saying. Before we started taping, you mentioned customer service, mm-hmm. and you were talking about Doctor on Demand. Tell me what you guys did there.
Yeah, so, you know.
And by the way, is there a liability part to that too? If something is misdiagnosed or anything like that?
Definitely, which is why we don't let our customer service reps practice medicine. That would be a felony. So they definitely don't do that. Doctor on Demand is a, you know, it's a different way to see a doctor, and it constitutes a big consumer behavior change. You're asking someone to not go to urgent care, not wait for the PCP, use the service instead. In order for that to go or to be a sustainable thing, in order for word of mouth to be the biggest growth driver, which it is for us, fortunately, you've got to nail consumer experience. You've got to nail that Net Promoter Score. And so that's part of that's building a great app, getting great doctors, getting the experience to look right visually. But also, if something goes wrong, we need to be right on top of it. So we knew this from the beginning. Like, it's easy for a Skype connection or a video connection to go out. Maybe your phone runs out of battery. Maybe God knows what. Maybe something happens on the provider side. There's all these reasons a call can fail. Mm-hmm. And if that happens, like, the poor patient is just out on her own, doesn't know what to do. So we, you know, built this in-house distributed customer service team that if there are any problems, it shoots to the top of the call board, assigns an agent right away, agent accepts, and then we call the patient and basically triage the situation. And it's usually like, hey, just reboot your phone, go back into the app, and you'll automatically reconnect. That's usually.
So it's proactive customer service.
It is. We reach out to you.
That's very rare.
Yeah, you'll get a call within 5 minutes. And that also released us from this like sort of inbound call queue problem, mm-hmm. you know, that all service companies have. I think what you guys do with, you know, triaging with bots is super smart. I think that's the future for sure. You know, we're not there yet because these are like medical things. They've got mm-hmm. some more high touch.
But if every company did that, my company probably wouldn't need to exist.
Possibly.
Because even, I mean, it's frustrating, right? Even, let's say you've navigated the phone tree and you're talking to a company, you've explained your issue. If the call drops, 99% of the time, that rep's not calling you back.
Right.
That's
yeah.
frustrating.
Yeah.
You guys are taking it to a whole other level and actually reaching out.
That's right. And it's great experience. Our head of customer service, a guy named Nino, has been with, he's like employee number 8. He's been with us since the beginning. Fantastic guy. consumer advocate kind of person, and he came up with this plan. And what it does actually is it will turn very negative net promoter score situations into very positive ones. And this isn't like this just happens like two or three times. This probably happens, you know, a couple times a week, you know, doing it, which is still a small percentage of, mm-hmm. of our volume. But we will get emails that say, hey, like someone on Nino's team or Nino himself, you know, really turned this thing around for me. Like, I'm going to tell all my neighbors and friends about this. Like, you just, that level of service, like, can dramatically change someone's point of view of your brand. So much so that, like, we were kind of scratching our heads, like, how do we scale this up? Because, like, the normal person who just comes in, has a 10, 12 minute conversation, leaves, gets their medicine, everything's fine, it's great. Their NPS might be in the low 70s, whereas the person who got the service is in the mid 80s.
There's so many studies about that, that if someone has a customer service issue, for a minute, their NPS might go down.
Yeah.
But then if you delight them with customer service, they're actually more loyal than if they'd never had the problem to begin with.
Yeah, yeah, we have definitely found that.
Yeah, it's fascinating. So at Service, obviously, we're trying to solve customer service with a mix of AI and humans. Mm-hmm. What was the last customer service issue you had in your life?
It was probably with Postmates, because I have an issue with them like probably weekly. I love Postmates, by the way. We eat lots of meals through them, but you
they're
know,
not sponsoring us. You can say whatever you want.
Yeah. Well, I know the guys over there too. I'm a huge fan. And you know, shit happens. You know, the driver, the restaurant's closed is usually what happens for us. So Postmates is pretty good at dealing with it. I had one with American Express recently, though. It was far less pleasant.
What happened?
I bought a plane ticket on this through this German travel agency website. It's a bad move on my part. I just wasn't thinking, because I needed one leg on this long, big, complex trip. And it was a fully refundable ticket. Ended up not needing the leg, so you know, we'll try to refund it. These sketch balls don't have no email address or phone number or anything, so I wasn't able to contact them. I tried emailing them, and so I'm like, fine, you know, I have a Platinum Amex, like that's why you have an Amex, right? So I, you know, filed a claim with Amex, and it was like a non-trivial amount of money, and you know, kind of forgot about it. And then Amex just canceled it. They're just like, yeah, they canceled my dispute, like never took the charge off. And wow. I was like doing the year-end closeout the other day, and I'm like, how could I have not gotten that money back? Like I was.
How much money was it?
It was like, you know, $1,000 or something like that.
And how long ago was this?
This was in July of last year. And I just noticed it a few weeks ago that okay. I never got my money back.
Can we help you with that? That's something we'd
Maybe,
be quite good at.
Yeah. Well, I reinitiated the claim and like wrote a super nasty letter.
Okay.
So we'll see. Now it's in process.
Well, we exist, so you don't have to take the time to write the super nasty letter.
I'm sure there will be many more in the future, so I'll have to use you guys next.
So going back to AI, where do you see really smart applications of AI in the future? Because you could make the argument AI is going to affect every industry and every worker, but where are the real sweet spots for AI?
Yeah, well, I think, you know, you kind of think about it in two categories. There's this world where the incumbents will continue to dominate in AI and things that need lots of training data. So cars that drive themselves, image rec. You know, these are things that are inherently great for a Google, Facebook, Tesla, Uber. But then if you think about just normal workflow software, like this is like a kind not the sexiest thing in the world, but you know, every job, every white collar job has some kind of software that they use to do their job, whether you're an executive administrative assistant, or you're a paralegal, or you're a CPA. You know, these people are using generally complete shit software. They may not even have a SaaS solution, let alone an AI-powered one. So, and if you think about so much of these people's workflow is just repetitive crap, so it's error-prone. They're working within very knowable systems, like, you know, accountants, like the tax code is complicated, but it's not infinite, right? Or the law, you know, the LegalZoom, you know, things like that. Like,
so you think any menial task will be automated?
Yeah, I don't think this is going to eliminate jobs. I think this will actually make sort of mid-level worker, information workers, jobs easier, less stressful, more accurate, more efficient, which may have like a sort of a small, like a moderate net drag on hiring, maybe, but. But more importantly, these people are going to be happier. Like that's why we call our lab Dopamine Labs. we're making software that makes you happy. Like this is, it's actually like fun to use, right? It's like what, you know, enterprise chat was never fun until Slack came along. Mm-hmm. You know, they figured that out.
Well, I think there's a whole trend. Previously, the consumer side would be like really sexy, and then you go behind the scenes and see what the agency is using. It looks like DOS.
Exactly.
That's changing.
That's changing, yeah. And it's the overused phrase, consumerization of enterprise software.
Yeah,
we get it. But AI is actually going to make that all, I think, come true. So pick a vertical, pick, you know, a horrible use case, and now you can build a great SaaS application that actually trains an AI to help you. I almost call it like, you know, like wearing an Iron Man suit.
So at Dopamine Labs, are you focusing on the boring yet potentially highly profitable parts of AI?
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's a better tagline, by the way. I think you should just use that.
All right,
that.
Good. Thank you.
Boring but profitable.
Got it.
What's it like being a dad of twins and trying to be an entrepreneur?
Well, it's much easier to be a dad of twins, you know, without a super high pressure kind of venture back job. As you know, being a venture back CEO is not the lifestyle job people portray it to be.
What do you mean? I'm at the beach all day.
Yeah, right? Sure you are.
Aren't you too?
Yeah. I am now. So it's, you know, part of actually a big part of my transition out of day-to-day at Doctor on Demand was, you know, being able to spend more time, be more flexible. So before that, though, it was very, very difficult.
When your kids were born, you were in the
I was still in the seat. Yeah. And it was, it was tough. Definitely the hardest thing I've been through. And our kids were born early, so we were at the NICU at UCSF for 6 weeks.
Wow.
And they were great. You know, they're healthy. Everything went fine. But yeah, it's tough. I would say it's much easier, you know, to run a venture back company without, you know, those sort of things. You know, a growing family. That it's you just got to be smarter with your time. You know, you got to. It's all about prioritization. I know some people who do it well, men and women. But it's you got to get better at saying no to things. You got to get better at delegation. And that's not always easy for 0 to 1 people.
Yep. Well, thank you for making the time to be on today and choosing this half an hour to spend with me.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Thanks. Did you like what you just saw? You want to see more? Go ahead and subscribe. We have new episodes every Tuesday. And if there's someone you want to see on the show, just add them as a comment down below. We'll take a look and we'll have them on if we can. Thanks again.